Hello and welcome to the first ever episode of the Movies in a Podshell podcast. I'm Jamie and I'm joined with my co-host, Jonny. Say hello, Jonny.
Being introduced as Jonny rather than John straight away, that's an interesting one. Hi there.
Well, yeah, as you can tell, we're like very good friends. So, the reason why we decided to do this, I've been thinking about it for quite a while now. I've wanted to do a podcast for ages, but I've never had anyone that would commit. And after bullying Jonny for weeks upon weeks,
that's right.
He finally accepted my offer.
Finally caved into the peer pressure and got involved. That's it.
Yep. So this week's going to be a little bit different to every other week, mostly because it's going to be super rusty because it's our first ever podcast, so please forgive. But essentially, the way it's going to go down is we're going to begin with a little quickfire round of you getting to know us. We're going to do our Mount Rushmore of favourite films and our favourite directors. If you don't know what a Mount Rushmore is, to our UK listeners, I'm sure there won't be many just yet, but if you're listening back years in advance when we've done 500 episodes, then you can know that Mount Rushmore is, there's four presidents on the Mount Rushmore wall, and we're going to pick our four favourite films and our four favourite directors that we would put on that wall if we got to build one. So we're not going to put them in order. They're just going to be randomly put up there because I actually couldn't put them in order.
It's too difficult. When you actually started getting me into that process, trying to actually order them was nigh on impossible. So I'm glad we're not doing that.
Exactly. And then after that, we're going to go straight into the featured film of the week, which I'm not going to reveal just yet. So you're going to have to carry on listening, I'm afraid. And then after that, we've got a few questions. I'll put some questions out to my Instagram followers, as I have an Instagram page, Movies in a Nutshell, hence the weird name, Movies in a Podshell, for the podcast. Anyway, so let's get right into it. Jonny, can you start me off with your... Let's start off with directors first, and I don't want to hear... Let's trade...
One for
directors.
One.
So you go, I go, you go, I go. So Mount Rushmore directors... In no particular order, Jonny, tell me.
No particular order, but I've put down first Alfred Hitchcock. Jamie is already smiling at me because he probably expected this one. I'm a massive fan of Alfred Hitchcock. I've read many, many books about him. I've studied his work. And then, I'm a sucker for especially Vertigo, love Psycho, love The Birds, but I also like the older stuff. We both recently watched Strangers on a Train. I'm a defender of Marnie. How niche are we going? Yeah.
Go as niche as you want, man. Like Hitchcock, I don't think not many people's going to argue with Alfred Hitchcock being on the wall of fame, nope. As it is. I guess if I'd seen more of his films, he'd probably be on my Mount Rushmore as well, but I've seen... He's done so many. I've only seen really a handful, like his biggest ones. I'm still yet to see The Birds. I've got a nice little box set of his.
Box set, which I'm actually very jealous of. It's got the artwork of the Psycho house on it and got all the discs. And this, I'm very jealous of that. It's really hard buying for anyone who wants to get into Hitchcock afterwards. Trying to get the Blu-rays and the collections of his films are really difficult because all the different studios own all the different rights. So no matter what box set you buy, it doesn't quite cover it. But Jamie's is the closest one I have seen to actually having everything in one box, which is the dream. Unfortunately, I've got about four different box sets which make up about the same amount of films, but
was something to do with did he leave the rights to all of his films to his daughter and she just sold them off to the highest bidder?
I think basically in his will he left some of the rights to some of the films to his daughter, as you said, and one of which was Vertigo was missing for years. People didn't have the reels or the prints, they were just kind of kept by the rights were with his daughter, and then eventually it was restored and it had a re-release, etc. Scorsese, as you know, big into his restoration projects and supporting that kind of thing. He cited Vertigo as being one of his favorite films, and I think he had a lot to do with the push to get that restored and when it had its re-release and that kind of thing.
Man, another reason to love Scorsese.
Am I guessing he might be one of the people on your list?
Well, yeah, do you know what? Let's just transition straight into... You'd save someone like him for last, but do you know, it's that obvious. Martin Scorsese is... I just absolutely love him. He was first on the list, to be honest. The reason being, I mean, I've heard him described as Mr. New York before, like by one of my friends. Like, And we had like a little like chat about that. Like, I don't see it. Like, yeah, he does. Yeah, he is a bit Mr. New York, but he's, I think he's so like, he's got such range, like such, so broad in his, I like when I'm choosing, like when I was looking at directors, I like to look at like all of their films and like how, mm-hmm. how consistent they are. And he is really consistent. He's done like a little bit of everything. Like, he's obviously a lot of gangster, but he's done Hugo, which is, it's kind of a kid's film, but it's animated.
Shutter Island.
You
know, something so different. Like, it's not really a horror, but it's more of a thriller, but so different to anything I'd expect from Scorsese of what I'd watched before, like Taxi Driver and that kind of thing. And
Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah.
King of Comedy. Like, mm-hmm. he can do, I feel like he could anything. Just do anything. And someone actually really said, well, I heard the other day actually that, Wolf of Wall Street is kind of like the end of his, like you've got Goodfellas, then you've got Casino, and then you've got the Wolf of Wall Street, which is like kind of looks into the grimy,
the progression of how negative capitalism, I don't know, that kind of
exactly,
thing.
Yeah, exactly, because you've got Goodfellas and Casino, mm-hmm. which like follow like gangsters like making loads of money in a really bad way, and then you've got kind of Wolf of Wall Street, which pairs really well with like those two films. And definitely. People say, like, I heard on a different podcast actually that they think that's like his third sort of, like, it's like it could be like a trilogy almost, which I really loved.
Yeah, go with that.
So yeah, I mean, that's, yeah, Scorsese's my number one on the list. I said I wasn't ordering them, but I kind of am now.
I know for you he is, though, and I think for me, I would say, yeah, I mean, I must admit, as we're doing this, Scorsese's not actually on my list, but it's not for a lack of. There's a few directors, which we'll get to, who it was really hard to leave off, but I think a lot of it comes down to obviously personal taste. But I went for things for the directors which I have a passion to rewatch, and Jamie knows I am a sucker for rewatching a lot of things a lot of times. What's been great about setting up and doing this is getting into, with the Tuesday recommendations, actually watching different films. But with Scorsese, there's such a diverse catalogue to go through for you to rewatch. I mean, yeah, amazing.
Awesome. So I reckon I could guess another two on your list, maybe.
Yeah,
so
I think you might.
Go on with the second. What's your second?
I'm going to surprise you. I'm going to go for David Fincher, which...
that's not a surprise.
No, so for context, me and Jamie have known each other now for 10 years, maybe slightly more now, but we were at university together and I was studying media and communications, and my dissertation was actually on David Fincher and his body of work. So I am a sucker for David Fincher, but I'm the kind of person who will defend Alien 3. We'll have that chat at a later date because I'm sure it will come up. So many films to pick from. My personal favourites, Seven. I really love Seven. Zodiac. Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, I think it's underrated.
Girl with the Dragon Tattoo is... like top three Fincher for me. Like, I think it's mad underrated as well. I love it.
So yeah, just really diverse. I mean, the only one which doesn't really sit great with me is The Game, but it's still a good film. It's just not for me what I want from a David Fincher film. And I think, I don't know if you have you seen The Game?
Haven't seen The Game. So okay. Really bad. So
not at all.
So I haven't seen The Game and I haven't seen The Social Network yet.
Okay.
I've seen all of his others though. Benjamin Button's being my least favourite, probably.
Yeah, and I think, again, what was weird was Benjamin Button was probably the one which was the most well-received kind of critically and with awards.
Oh, God, yeah.
Which is really...
so boring.
And I think it's some directors find that. They, you know, it's like Scorsese, when he finally won his Oscar. What did he actually win it for? Let's get this right. Which film did he actually get?
Now you're putting me on the spot.
I'm putting you on the spot.
He's my favourite director, but I can't tell you what he's won his first Oscar for.
Okay, but so many films that he had done which people expected...
Is it not Raging Bull?
No, in my head, this is bad for us on our first episode, but here we go. In my head, it was far later in the day when he actually got acknowledged. And I mean, you know...
not Wolf of Wall Street then, like, it wasn't that late, was it?
No.
We're fakers and we're phonies on our first
episode.
That's
it. Jamie's like hustling to his phone straight away to find the answer.
Well,
he loves it. But what I was going to say as he does that is I love Hitchcock, but, you know, he was never really... He always described himself as always the bridesmaid, never the bride, because he never got that recognition. He had so many films which were thought down upon at the time or not critically well received, and then it's only now that we see them in that way. You know, a lot of Fincher's films, when they first came out, Seven was seen as, oh, it's so repugnant, and how can it be, you know, spoilers for a film from 1995, people, but you know, there's some pretty dark, gratuitous things in that film, but actually a lot of it you don't see, but people built it up so much as if it was such a, you know, terrible thing. it's sometimes got negative reviews for that, even though it's a really good film. It's just, you know, anyway, that's
crazy. So, just so you know, it's a real surprise. It's The Departed, so that's what
there you go. Yeah,
Oscar for.
Yeah, and it's that whole thing of, you know, I really like The Departed actually.
It's a remake,
A lot of films he's done before, which people probably would have expected would have done and got the awards and didn't. But yeah, that's the Academy system.
It's really when you look at his body of work, and he's he hasn't won any before 2007. It's a bit ridiculous.
So yeah, right, next then. Director for you. Come on.
Right, so I'm going to go completely, I'm going to throw you a complete curveball and go for John Hughes.
That is a curveball. I was not expecting that at all.
No one's
ever
going to expect
that.
But it's just me. And to be honest, I'm fully aware that he's not. There's a lot of directors out there that are far, far more prestigious and have made more masterpieces. But for me, he is... like he got me through my teens, like with The Breakfast Club. He's Ferris Bueller's Day Off, mm-hmm. Planes, Trains and Automobiles. He's just got such a, he's so consistent. Only actually made 8 films, but so the film I was telling you to watch the other day, Uncle Buck.
Yes.
Another one of my absolute favorites. He wrote Home Alone.
It's weird because John Candy, I noticed for the first time, I don't know how I'd not noticed all these, is in Home Alone. And then you, when you recommended that film to me, obviously it's John Candy as well. So yeah, that was interesting.
So he's in Home Alone. He's the sax player or whatever he plays.
Big band,
Exactly. But John Hughes, like, I kind of just fall in love with his films. Like, I can just put them on again and again and again. Like, Breakfast Club's, like, easily in my top 10. I think it's not particularly like he's very like almost one note, you could call him, like it's mm-hmm. just he's that kind of like,
but it's
he's
that good film. You don't care, that's the main thing, right?
It's just it's really lighthearted. I found his films when I was at that particular age, that just
the right age for them to
kind of like
resonate.
You just really appreciate it, like so yeah, John Hughes. No one's gonna
love it.
It was like, where's Spielberg? He's not on the list. There you go. All right, go on. What's your next?
That
one?
Was a really good link without knowing it's a link, because Jamie's not actually seen my list, but I have actually got Spielberg on there. I was really torn with this because I've not.
I'm sorry for ruining your big reveal.
No, it's fine.
Sorry for ruining your big
reveal. Me and Jamie talked about this before, and we've just said it with Scorsese, but it's about, if you've got a diverse portfolio, and another director I will mention shortly, it makes it so, you know, so many films they've got that you can't not like them. I mean,
oh my God, he has got a diverse portfolio.
I remember, you know, as a kid, obviously it was the obvious ones like Indiana Jones and Jurassic Park, but then you've got stuff like Munich. Okay, you know, who would have thought that? Schindler's List, obviously, you know.
E.T.
E.T., that's a good one.
Saving Private Ryan.
Ridiculous. But the point is just the diverse talent in terms of whatever he does. It's a lot of people talk about his direction, a lot of it is the way he blocks through a scene. So he sees, he apparently says he sees things through 35mm to his eye, which, interesting, I don't think that's true. But anyway, I can't say it's basic, that's not what I mean, but the shots aren't always as complicated as you think they might be. It's more the blocking of the scene and how the energy and the action it brings to it, especially the first few Indiana Jones films, like the first one especially, which is it's not independently made, but it's that kind of, the energy and the roughness to that film absolutely amazing, like watching it back. Similar to other things I've watched recently, including The Raid, which has that kind of energy, and you can tell, you know.
We'll talk about that later.
Sorry, your next one after Spielberg.
Spielberg was a whisker away from being on my list, because, again, like I said, I base it on their body of work, and crazily consistent. It's just ridiculous. Like, his career's been so long, and he's been so prolific. Like,
quick question on that. Did you enjoy Ready Player One, which is probably a bit of a tangent right now?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, it was good. It was. I've read the book, so the book is, like, far and away better than anything the film ever could have been. So yeah, the film for me was not true to the book. So it's fine. It's fine. I enjoyed it. I didn't hate it. So yeah, that's that.
Okay, next one.
Right then. So, I'm gonna go. Right, I'll put my most obvious one next, and I'll save my most niche one for last. So quite obviously Quentin Tarantino,
because of course,
little film bro,
of course.
Or so we get called for liking Scorsese and Tarantino. Again, like, his body of work is so consistent. You cannot fault what he does. You could probably say that, like, a lot of his films are of a similar nature, maybe. Like, but like in terms of like he's done his Hong Kong action. Like he basically makes films that he sort of grew up watching. Like
100%.
That he like fell in love with, like as he was getting older. So like that's why you've got those like your Kill Bills and Hateful Eight is, but then you've got Reservoir Dogs, which he kind of like, I think he struggled to get that released. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, because it was really hard for him to get it released there, because no one wanted to know, but they read the script and couldn't believe what he'd written. So the fact that he writes and directs,
he feigned an acting credit as well. I'm sure it was something about he feigned an acting credit early on to be able to get cast in like his own movie or something. Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I watched his documentary a while ago. So I can't remember the Reservoir Dogs thing, but yeah, he's made. I really hate throwing the word masterpieces around or masterpiece around, but he has. Like Pulp Fiction, it's never going to be. It's just unbelievable. Like, in as much as you want to say, like, it gets talked about too much for a reason, because it's.
Yeah,
we'll be lucky to ever see anything like it again.
Yeah, and this is the problem with films like you say that get that much critical acclaim. It's then really easy to bash it with, oh, it's not that good, and it's like, well, but at the time it came out, it truly was, because no one had seen it before. If you in context and have seen all the things that have been ripped off from it and come from it, like all those Guy Ritchie films, Snatch and whatever, that style would not exist without Pulp Fiction, right?
People say that like Tarantino rips other films off, but. I don't think he rips films off. He sort of is inspired by.
Yeah.
It's just inspiration for him. Like he wants to sort of like, he's such a big fan of film that he just wants to portray that on the screen, like in his own vision of it. Like, so the hyper-violence, no one writes dialogue like him, in my opinion. Like he writes dialogue like no one else. I could sit and watch a half an hour conversation between two characters and not be bored, which is very, very rare. So how can you not mention him? So let's hear your final pick. I'm trying to think of who it could be. There's a couple there that I could guess, but go on, hit us with
the next
one.
This was so hard, and I've got to say, I always feel like I need to give a reason why I've done this before I've even said what it was. My final pick is Ridley Scott, but what I must say, Jamie again is going to say knew it. The thing for me was I almost had James Cameron in. The reason
that
being...
That would have been another guess of mine, maybe, that you would have had him
because
in.
I, growing up, for some reason, when I probably shouldn't have been watching it, I was obsessed with Terminator 1 and 2, and I actually personally still prefer Terminator 1, which is a very off-the-wall thing to say, I think, but I like the fact it's basically a self-contained movie, and although as good a sequel as 2 is, it kind of doesn't work within... What,
greatest
the first
sequel
setup.
Of all time, maybe?
Yeah, I would. Do you know what? I'd still agree with that. But But then, you know, James Cameron also, by the way, makes brilliant sequels. Aliens. Again, you'll probably get from this part of the podcast already very early on, I'm a big fan of the Alien series. I almost put Kubrick in, but then I thought I'd be a bit of a fraud with that, because the truth is I have seen probably 4 or 5 of his films. And I can't say I've seen enough of his older body of work to say I'm a true fan. Like, at least with Hitchcock, I can say I have basically seen everything that you can physically see, by the way, because you can't even get some of his films because they are literally lost. What you can own and can see, I have seen and I do enjoy. But with Kubrick, there's stuff earlier on I've not seen. I love 2001. I know Jamie's not watched it, and I hope at some point we do get to watch it and talk about it together. Yeah, I am straight away.
I haven't watched it, no. Do you know what, though? I bought, it's funny you say that. I have only seen 2 Kubrick films.
Yeah.
Like, just 2.
Yeah.
Because it just wasn't where my... it's just not in my wheelhouse when I was growing up. I was just pure 80s.
Yeah.
An 80s kid. Like, just watch anything to do with 80s action films. So I've only seen A Clockwork Orange and, obviously, The Shining. So now I've bought it.
Yeah.
So... I'm very, very excited. I've held off on 2001 because I wanted to watch it in 4K Blu-ray.
100%.
And that's going to happen.
Yeah. So rather than talking about all the people I've not put on my list, I should probably talk about the person who actually has gone on my list, which is Ridley Scott. I didn't realize how much of a recurring theme this would be for all of us, but everyone we've said so far, we've talked about having such a diverse body of work. Ridley Scott has a very diverse body of work.
God, he does.
I mean, you know, obviously, Alien was the film that got me hooked on Ridley Scott, and I'm sure a lot of people under the same influence. Blade Runner for obvious reasons, despite the plot not being all that it's cracked up to be. I would say the visuals are obviously amazing. But what I love about Ridley is he's also done... He's great at world building. So take something like Gladiator, which was obviously one of his more recent things. I say recent, actually, that was 2000. That's literally 20 years ago now, but there we are.
It still feels recent.
It feels recent. And then Thelma Louise, just such a diverse cast.
Black Hawk Down.
Love Black Hawk Down.
Yeah, ridiculous, like really, really
but
good.
But again, just a director, unfortunately, he's only as good as his script, as the script he's given, because with him being so great at concentrating on visuals, I would agree that sometimes he does pick up some not great scripts. I mean, I was really excited for The Counselor, and I don't know if you've seen that film, but I wasn't particularly...
I've not seen it, now.
Yeah, I wasn't particularly...
Yeah, he has made a few stinkers. Like, like you say, though, he is consistent.
But he's also prolific. I mean, he's an older man now, let's say. He's an older gentleman, but he's very much adamant that he loves to work, and he just gets project after project, and he's known for, like, bringing in these projects under budget on time, which is just amazing. Wow. And probably helps if you've got your own production company. That probably makes you think more a little bit about it, potentially. But yeah, Ridley Scott for me. I'm sure we'll get onto watching some of his films. I really can't wait to get stuck in and tell you what we know. So Jamie, your last one.
Right then, so my last one is I deleted Fincher off the list because I knew you'd have him on there, and I didn't want to be boring for everyone. So my last one, and this has only been kind of recent, really, Park Chan-wook.
I did actually expect you to say this, because our WhatsApps recently have a lot been about that subject in itself, so I thought that might be the case. Tell me more.
Like, I mean, I think it's the way he has such an amazing mind, like, and I've not seen a great deal of Korean cinema. I've probably seen more Korean cinema than I have any other sort of, like, apart from like UK, like, so any other like world cinema, like Korean's probably the most I've seen. But watching, so obviously you start with the Vengeance trilogy, Old Boy, and I was like, oh yeah, like Old Boy's supposed to be the best. And I was like, I watched it and I was like absolutely blown away, like the twist in that film and the way he just the thoughts he has, like it wasn't like anything I'd ever seen.
The cinematography is stunning as well.
Oh god,
I must say, just before Jamie goes off and I'm calling myself out here, I've only actually seen Old Boy, and I am well aware that I do need to broaden my horizons with that, and I'll take that on the chin. But I studied some of the cinematography for Old Boy at university, and also I think I sent it you at the time when I was traveling. I had a book on cinematography, and literally so many examples were just from Old Boy, because it just had such good examples of all these different shot types and all these really creative things. It's stunning, literally.
For me, that's not even his best film. So the Sympathy for Mr. Vengeance is obviously the start of the Vengeance trilogy, which they're not, I can't remember what you call it now. They're not an actual trilogy, but they're like...
A linked theme rather than...
A link, yeah, that's it. Yeah, a thematic trilogy, that's what it is.
Love it.
Yeah, you're right. Sympathy for Mr. Vengeance, although really, really bleak, and in God it's bleak, he does stuff you never, ever expect. Like, he just has guts, like... And so my favourite film from him is The Handmaiden, which was actually only released in 2016. Again, that's on Netflix at the moment, for anyone who hasn't watched it. Another sort of, a film you would never expect. Like, you're just not going to expect anything that happens in it. Like, shot beautifully, the colours he uses, the way he frames his shots. Like, he writes and directs. I haven't seen a bad film from him. A little hidden gem that he's got is a film called Thirst. It's a vampire film about a vampire priest.
Okay.
Who is infected. It's really interesting and really funny. Like, oh yeah, that's, an, yeah. So all of his films have got this, like,
underlying
crazy,
dark humor. Yeah.
Like, this undercurrent of, like, you kind of don't know whether you should be laughing or not.
Yeah.
He is. Right. We haven't even done the top four Mount Rushmore films. So let's go. What, Jonny, give me your first one.
Again, I'm saying no particular order. I've got Alien, which links in nicely to my Ridley Scott. Reference, I've got Vertigo. Battle. I've got Seven.
There are seven deadly sins. Gluttony.
You're going to come take a look at this.
Greed.
No one touches anything.
Sloth. Wrath. pride, lust, and envy. Seven. You can expect five more of these.
Which is obviously David Fincher.
Nice.
And then the one that's probably a massive curveball is Honor Majesty's Secret Service.
My name's Bond. James Bond.
The new Bond.
Suppose I were to kill you for a thrill.
The different 007.
Now, really, really had to think hard for putting this on my list. I'd love to talk through each film, but I'll pick this one as this one's the most controversial to discuss. Yes, it's the first one without Sean Connery. Yes, it's the one which a lot of people look down upon because it's the one-time Bond. But some of the things and the cinematography and the editing they were trying in that film, I won't say they were ahead of their time because the other films were kind of stuck in the early 60s era. This film was trying to do different things. It was trying to be inspired by like the Kung Fu movies and that kind of thing that were coming over. They were trying to import that style, and I just love it. It's also, I've watched it recently, obviously, because of Christmas, and it is kind of inadvertently a Christmas film like Die Hard is. It's that kind of thing. But just George Lazenby, I don't want to ruin it because Jamie's not seen it, but all I'll say is...
I haven't seen it, no. We spoke about it.
Yeah, like, there's plot twists in that film, and he gets a lot of flack. And the thing that's frustrating is his character has to pretend to be someone else for a large period of the film, and he's dubbed over, and it does him no favours. But in terms of some of the action in that film, it's incredible. Neither of us have spoken about Christopher Nolan yet, which I find really interesting, but I think that's a topic for another day. But what I would say is the whole end of Inception is very much inspired by Honor Majesty's Secret Service. It literally looks so similar. Like, yeah, so it's his favourite. It's his favourite of the Bond films, apparently. It's like one of the first ones that really hooked him. And when I saw Inception the first time, I thought, oh my God, it's Honor Majesty's Secret Service in whatever year it was when Inception came out, and it blew my mind. That was a real controversial pick. Very quickly, Seven, you've heard of my love, David Fincher, so no need to really go into that. Vertigo, I was so lucky. I saw Vertigo so late in the day. I lived in Australia for a year, and when I was there, I joined a cinema club. I was by far the youngest member, but I loved it. It was great. And it was this old independent cinema, and they had Hitchcock showings every other week for a month.
I'm so jealous of this. You told me about
Jamie would have absolutely loved this, and I did message. I remember messaging you at the time, telling you about it, and just said you would love it here. This is so up your street. And the first thing I saw was Rear Window, which I really enjoyed. But obviously, Rear Window is quite a slow burn, slow pace, but really interesting. And then I got to see Vertigo for the first time. Again, I won't ruin Vertigo for people who haven't seen it, despite the fact it's such an old film. But it's famous for having lots of twists in the plot, and the Hitchcock MacGuffin.
The twist will still surprise many people. Like it surprised me when I watched it,
and it's almost a twist within a twist as well. So every time you think you're kind of on
Inception.
Top of it, well, there you go.
There you go. Nolan strikes again.
Yeah. So I just absolutely adored it, and the cinematography, all of it. I just absolutely love it. And then Aliens top for me, because Aliens literally the reason why I went to study film and TV. All of that for me was from watching a behind the scenes disc called The Making of Star Beast, which was the working title of the film, and I was obsessed.
And this is Alien, sorry, not
this
not
is
the
Alien,
first,
the first, the original.
Right, okay.
I'm currently reading a massive Taschen coffee table book all about the behind the scenes. It's literally a breakdown day by day what was filmed, who said what, who did this, and it is just for me just paradise. I keep pacing about it. Absolutely love it. So you're four, Jamie.
Right then. So remember, everyone, these are just my favorite films. So just leave me be. So, The Lost Boys.
Michael and Sam have just moved to Santa Carla, California. They're about to discover its secret.
Notice anything unusual about Santa Carla yet?
No. It's a pretty cool place. If you're a Martian.
Or a vampire.
Again, an absolute banger.
Roadhouse.
Can I buy you guys a drink? Guess not.
Patrick Swayze is...
Dalton.
I thought you'd be... bigger.
Opinions vary.
Yeah, you've seen Roadhouse, Jonny?
I haven't. I've seen a trailer for it, and I'm sure you can get me to watch it at some point.
Oh, you will. Oh, you will watch it. Right, yeah. Dirty Dancing.
Nobody puts Baby in a corner.
Yeah, good.
We obviously knew that was going to be on the list.
Of course.
And Goodfellas.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
I know I'd go from rags to riches if you would only say you care. And though my pocket may be empty.
Good fans. As you know, of all the Scorsese's you were going to pick, I'm staggered that was the one you went for, actually. That was quite interesting.
Really? Why?
Yeah,
did I go for instead?
I don't know. I wasn't sure what Scorsese you would go for, but it's just intrigued me that was the one.
So I think that Goodfellas, was it the first Scorsese I've seen? Maybe not. No, I think so. I've seen Casino when I was far, far too young, and it was a two in the morning showing on like Channel 4.
Yeah.
And it was the part when... I'm really sorry. No, in fact, I won't
really. Don't spoil
years.
It.
Yeah, just.
I know the fact we're saying don't spoil it for films that have been out for like 20, 30 years, even
exactly,
longer with
yeah.
Vertigo, but there we go, 1958,
exactly.
But hey.
So yeah, like,
we're looking after
super,
you guys.
Super violent. So yeah, I mean, Goodfellas for me, I think that's probably that is a film maybe that deserves to be on the Mount Rushmore films, as in like, it could be considered one of the greatest ever. The tracking shot to me, did a bit in media, that tracking shot, that means cinema to me. Like, I see that and like I genuinely, the magic, like it just gives me like proper, I don't know, just puts a massive smile on my face. I'm like, this is cinema. Like, I know that sounds really cheesy and weird, but like,
everyone has that one thing or like a scene in a film which kind of grips them. And for me, it's a similar tracking shot. Well, it's not a similar tracking shot. There's a hell of a lot more choreography going on in your one. But at the start of Alien, there's a really simple tracking shot which is going through the ship, and it's just the empty corridors, and it just feels real. But it's a really simple thing. I've now learned they had it on a dolly, and it was on a track, and it was going through. And it goes on and on and on and on and on.
Yeah.
But what's amazing, because there's no cut, you are sucked into that world. You're there.
Exactly.
And because also in Alien, you see the ceiling. Now, normally in films, obviously, you have lighting at the top, or back in the day, you used to have lots of lighting over the top of the set going down into it. So if you can show the ceiling, as an audience, you go, oh my God, like, this is real, because I can see the ceiling. There's no out, there's no escape.
Yeah.
And it's.
Yeah. So I think so, like, I don't, oh man, like, yeah, that Goodfellas, just, I think the whole film, like, it's 2.5 hours and the pacing is just... amazing for
it
me.
Doesn't
like,
feel
seen
like
it
two
in,
and a half
I've seen
hours
the four, no not at
that's
all,
the point
but 4K restoration, I've seen it in the cinema. It might have actually been like the beginning of 2020. No, it wasn't. So yeah, it was actually when the cinemas opened a little bit again. So to see that scene, like, yeah, so the tracking shot I was talking about, the reason why that's so effective is because what Scorsese was trying to achieve, he wanted to show that there was no doors, as in like there was no boundaries, like he could just like walk in just behind everything. Like, it was, I think they did like 7 takes on it. It's so long. And it basically,
and the amount of choreography, like, just to have all those people in the right place at the right time, that's what's crazy. It's just
but just in terms of a film, it's pretty close to perfect for me. A little bit about the other two. Funny, Patrick Swayze features twice, Dirty Dancing and Roadhouse. Dirty Dancing, I think, is like a really important film for me, just because it was it might have even got me into film properly. Like, I used to watch it with my nan all the time. Like, it was one of her favorite films. I love the soundtrack so much. Like, that music is my jam. Roadhouse, again, had it on VHS. Just used to go around like car boot sales. Like, if you don't know what a car boot sale is, US, it is like a flea market. Is that what they call it? I don't know.
I don't know. It's kind of like a yard sale, surely. Shit. It's
people
a yard
just selling
sale.
Their old shit. It's a car sale, yeah. Well, I don't know what they call it yet. People sell
garage sale.
Garage. Oh, sorry,
yes,
man. I didn't hear you like three times.
No, I said yard, to be fair. But it's
okay. They literally, like, people just selling their old shit that they don't want. Somehow someone didn't want Roadhouse and I got it.
And how lucky, imagine how different your life would have been if you'd not bought Roadhouse. Like, you might not have been on this podcast. That could have been the end of your cinema knowledge. Just only Dirty Dancing and no Roadhouse.
Can you imagine? Yeah. The two like pure weird films. And The Lost Boys, obviously, again, it was in that kind of
same era.
My teenage phase, like that James that John Hughes era, although it's directed by Joel Schumacher. I mean, I'm sure, do you know what? He might even come up later on the podcast.
Ooh.
Yeah, intriguing. You're wondering what that is. So that's it, everyone. Like, that's our favorite films and favorite directors. So why don't we move on to the main body of the podcast, which is going to be the featured film we watched this week. Jonny, what did we watch this week?
We watched Dredd.
800 million people living in the ruin of the old world. Only one thing fighting for order in the chaos. The men and women of the Hall of Justice.
Or Dredd 3D as it was released, which really did not help it during its release. But yes, Dredd.
Dredd 3D, is that what it's actually called?
So, for people who don't know, Dredd came out in 2012, and it was after Avatar when it got commissioned, and everything at that time was either being converted into 3D, terribly in post-production, and it looked like a pop-up book, or films were being told to be shot in 3D. And to be fair, Dredd was actually shot in 3D. And they do some really interesting things with it. I must say that I've not seen it in 3D, but I know the sections which would look good in 3D, if that makes sense. Yeah. But
I guess we should tell people what it's about.
That's it. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, which I definitely didn't forget on the first ever episode where you're giving us just a little bit of leeway. Right. So Dredd is essentially about a post-apocalyptic, I guess, dystopian, like, wasteland kind of thing. And basically the crime rate is super, super high. So police are now judges. So the idea is that there can be the judge, the jury, and the executioner.
That's correct.
I guess. Yeah. Yep. So, yeah.
There's a lot of capital punishment in Dredd.
Oh, God, yeah. So so there and then, they can literally decide whether you are guilty or not and do what the law says. And they abide by the law. It is fully black and white, no matter what. So even if there is no gray areas, it's just you're either guilty or you're innocent. And they're like these like super powerful cops, I guess, like with these crazy guns with all different... What would you describe? It's got like loads of different modes on the gun.
Isn't it called the Lawmaker or something? It's just the weapons have like different modes, and the modes go from normal bullets, which look pretty intense. Then they have a round, which is an incendiary unit. Is it a fire one?
Incendiary.
That's not very good for me. And then there's another one, which it's more like a stun feature he uses later in the film.
It's
ace, basically.
Yeah. It's not quite a Star Trek phaser.
No, it looks like a normal pistol, and we'll get onto the production values and kind of how it looks. But yeah, it looks more like a plausible near future rather than a very drastic future, which you saw in Dredd 95. But sorry, I'll let you carry on with the synopsis.
Yeah, I'm sure a lot of people know what Dredd is anyway. Essentially, the story's like dead easy, like dead simple. Judge Dredd and a kind of like a new recruit, like she's like failing at being a recruit. So she's going to fail. But the one thing,
Judge Anderson,
special thing about her, she's got like these abilities, and like she's a mutant. Yeah. So she's got these abilities where she can see what people are thinking. And then so she gets given to Dredd and Dredd's going to essentially pass her or fail her, and they go on this drugs bust for this new drug that's just been released. What's the drug called again, Jonny?
Slow-mo. You know?
Slow-mo, that's it.
Nice,
yeah.
Clear and obvious name. And,
yeah, and I'm sure the drug was designed just so they could do it in 3D, probably, by the sound of it. Do you reckon?
I don't know. I think it's interesting, though, that with the amount of stories that are in the 2000 AD catalogue, they made a completely new drug, which wasn't in the comics at all. But hey, just to clarify before we go further into this, I'm not actually well-versed in 2000 AD lore. I have a general knowledge from other podcasters and from other YouTube videos I've watched around this subject.
Novel.
Jamie's. Oh, there you go.
I bought the first volume because of this film.
Okay, as
like years ago,
as a throwback, I used to go to the library on a Saturday with my dad, and I actually one of the first graphic novels I ever rented was Dredd. It was 2000 AD, but oh, wow. I think it was Dredd versus Alien. So I don't think it's very good as a
anything with
as
aliens.
A gauge of the quality of Dredd in general. Yeah. But there we are.
So I mean, Jonny. What did you think of it?
I really enjoyed it. Few caveats for me before I get into this. I'm not massively into really violent films, and Jamie always laughs at me about this. But I'm kind of a hypocrite because then I'll watch other things that are quite gratuitous, like Alien Covenant, and not have a problem. Dredd is a dark and quite brutal film in a lot of respects, but it's shot in such a way. It's kind of beautiful. It's really, really strange.
I would agree. Like, it is. There's the bit. One of the bits that like hit me at the beginning was when the main character, well, the main villain, Mama, played by Lena Headey, was she was obviously on slow-mo and she's like playing with the water.
Yes.
And it just it really is a great example of a low budget film that if the right vision is there. And it's executed like the script was. I mean, I have a couple of things to say about the script, which was quite funny. But yeah, if it's got a decent script, you've got no excuse but to make. They made a great film, I think. Yeah, I loved it.
I think someone described it to me as all the money's been put in the right place, and I think it has.
Yeah.
And
that's a really good apart from the CGI by the looks of it.
I mean, I don't know. I think for a film of its budget, I think it's held up well. I think you've got to contextualize it with it. I think it was 40 million budget, and I think
45 million.
Right. Okay. So in the grand scheme of things, it looks bang for buck. I think the reason they've chosen to do it in the tower block was obviously to save money. And I've known we've discussed the fact that they only built 3 levels and just reshot it a lot of times, different angles. But
redressed it.
Yeah, but that happens far more than you think. In terms of the look of the film, what I found really interesting about Dredd, apart from the slow-mo, which is the bit everyone will talk about, they had a camera which filmed 3,000 frames per second. And for context for people, films normally at 24 frames per second. My camera shoots 100 frames per second slow-mo, and I use that for sports videography, and we think that looks pretty good slowed down. So if you've got 3,000, you are talking epic levels. It almost looks like a still image practically. The scene Jamie's just talked about is an amazing example of the cinematography, because Mama at the start of the film takes, they use inhalers like asthma inhalers to have the drug, and as she takes the drug, everything slows right down. So it goes from normal speed, you know, water in a bath, not a problem. It goes up and down. It's not very interesting. If you slow it down to 3,000 frames per second, it looks amazing and you're seeing the high. But what's amazing is that shot is actual foreshadowing, because at the start she lifts up the bathwater, she watches it drop, and she's watching all the reflections as they go down. And the last thing that happens in the film, spoilers again for Dredd 2012, are we allowed to discuss the ending? I'm presuming we are, as we are.
I mean, are you going to tell me that the bad guy dies?
Well, yeah.
Because, I mean, like, what can we say?
Funnily enough, Mama does meet a demise. And when she does, what's interesting is she is given the drug before she dies, and she shatters a glass window, and the glass window, the first shot that reveals her is water and the sparkles and her looking up at them and being in awe, and the last shot is her looking at the glass all smashed up to pieces.
Love that.
In awe as it goes down, and
love that.
It's amazing. It's again, as I've rewatched this, that it was good foreshadowing, kind of seeing how that leads into it. But a couple of things for me as well. It wasn't just the slow-mo sequences which stood out. You've got to contextualize. When Dredd came out, you've got things like Batman Begins, The Dark Knight. It was kind of, if you made something which was dark and gritty, it had to literally be desaturated and dark and gritty. And what was really interesting for me with Dredd is it wasn't. It's a really colourful film. He's got the red on his helmet, which is like quite clear. Yeah, he's in bike leathers, which is a bit more of a tactical Dredd, let's say. But there's some really bright colours and you know, sounds daft, but there's a lot of red, there's a lot of yellow, a lot of green. It all pops out at you, and it didn't follow the trend, what I'm saying, of the films at the time, which was, you know, Terminator Salvation came out in 2009, and it's literally desaturated.
Let's not talk about that film.
In general, films at that time, it was like, we're dark, we're serious, we turn saturation down, right? That is how it was. So I really like the fact it didn't do that. And then when they do the slow-mo sequences, the saturation bumps up like another level.
Yeah, you almost like get the feeling that like you get that experience of being on drugs. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
that, 100%. That's where I've seen it. So like when it slows down like that, it's like that's you're looking through like the eyes of someone that's taking the slow mo.
And there are multiple sequences that do that. For me, another thing that I enjoyed, well, I'll say I enjoyed it, it's that stood out to me was the score. The score's really harsh and oppressive. It's very electronic. It's very driving.
I love the score.
Yeah, it's
really loved it.
It's recorded from there's all these weird noises which he recorded and sampled and played back and played them at different energies and beats, and it's all very clever. I mean, I wouldn't recommend it for easy listening, but I would say with the film it works so well. But basically, what I loved about Dredd was the energy. So you start off with this chase scene and it's trying to establish who Dredd is, okay? So he's on a bike and there's three perps in a car. They're all taking slow-mo. They have no link to the rest of the film. It's just the fact it's introducing, here's a drug. When you take it, everything slows down. Okay, fine. Yeah. Next thing is, here's Judge Dredd on a bike. And what's really interesting is you learn a lot about his character. The first thing you learn about his character is he watches a pedestrian get run over by the guys he's pursuing. He doesn't even bat an eyelid. He doesn't turn back for him. He swerves to avoid him as he's in the road and he keeps on going. And that's a really good say, okay, no nonsense. He goes in for, well, I say in for the kill, but he's going to go and chase them down. And I don't think he even calls a paramedic. I think
it's the only thing that matters. The only thing that matters is the bad guy.
I found that really like
serving justice.
It's a really good little visual thing though of just establishing this character. He doesn't even have to say it. And it establishes the system of how it works with the judges, because he radios in and says, you know, I've got three perps, I'm going this way.
So show not tell instead, like
generally. Yeah, and there's a big thing. Yeah, 100%. And one of the reasons the first Terminator was so successful was like every time you are told about the future in those scenes and the action, it's during a car chase. So you're like, oh my God, high energy. And then you're learning all this new information. And this is exactly what Dredd does in the opening 10 minutes, very much the same. The other thing is, I've been told that the original script was actually a lot harsher. Now, I found Dredd quite harsh in general, but...
Oh, man, I'm glad you mentioned the script.
Yeah, like, I'll let you talk about that. Go for it.
It's like, so it's got that 80s action film vibe.
100%.
Like, so many one-liners. Like the bit where, so I actually wrote it down because it was like, I just thought it was hilarious. Carl Urban plays Dredd, who we haven't mentioned, like, and we love Carl Urban, don't
we? Yeah, 100%. Love him as Dr. McCoy.
He's great in pretty much everything. He's he does the upside down smile like that we all know Dredd from. But the amount of one-liners in there just reminds you of like an 80s like Arnie film or something like that. There's a bit where he's like the woman at the start's like, oh, throw her in the deep end, and he's like, it's all the deep end.
Yeah,
like, it's just like so hokey, like it was like really funny as well. But they don't all land. Like, I found that some of the one-liners like didn't really land for me. Like, it was like, yeah, like just like the whole like choke on this, like kind of stuff.
Yeah,
like, it was a bit like cheesy, but mate, like it didn't offend me, like, because I feel like that's what they were going for.
I do believe as well, from my understanding, and again, probably not the best context, is from Dredd versus Alien, but apparently the whole idea of Dredd is like he's part of the 2000 AD world, but he's almost not the main character. And the idea of Dredd is basically a caricature. It's a caricature of, you know, hard right justice in the US. It's almost like
society, innit? Yeah.
Yeah, it's like cowboys almost. It's like we go and take out, well, I suppose it's not cowboys, but lawless. But it's that kind of, you know, at any cost, the law is the law we will enforce. And
there's an underlying political commentary like throughout it.
But what I think is the issue, and this is the problem with Dredd's adaptation so far, especially the 95 one with Stallone, which I know we're not talking about, but I think it saw him
can mention it real quick.
Yeah, it saw him as a superhero, and it was obsessed with getting his helmet off, and it's Judge Dredd stands for the law, and he's a caricature of that idea, okay? It's not the fact of he's a superhero who goes and chases people down. I kind of watched Dredd thinking, they're all as bad as each other. I mean, yeah.
So how do you feel about this, right? When I was watching it, I was like, right. And I don't hate Judge Dredd, the Stallone version. Like, I think it is what it is. Like, it's pretty fun, like, I think. Like, I haven't seen it in years, but and I wasn't going to go and rewatch it for this. But I liked it. Anyway, what I wrote down was, how about Judge Dredd, the Stallone version, Batman Forever, Dredd, Dark Knight, in terms of, like, the way they're both presented. Like, that's the feel it gave me. Like, it gave me that, like, pure Batman Forever, like a bit more like kiddie, kind of like bright colors, like, and I like Batman Forever, to be fair. Like, I think it's an ace film.
Well, that's another chat for another day.
but yeah, and
Dredd, I know what you're saying. It's
weird you mentioned earlier, like Dredd is like, that definitely gave me like that Dark Knight vibe.
And he was very much a product of that time. And you got to think at that point, this is before Marvel had really kicked into high gear with their films. So people were lapping up these comic book properties, but they almost don't know what to do with Dredd. I mean, the 95 film was proof of, they basically made Demolition Man 2. But
I'm glad you mentioned that.
They kind of were like, oh, Dredd, as I said, Dredd's a superhero and all this, and it's not about him as a person, it's what he stands for is the thing with Dredd, not who he is. But we do get good, you know, just to be clear, Carl Urban doesn't take his helmet off through the entire film. He puts it on at the start and you never actually get to see it. So he has to emote everything through his body language and his mouth, which sounds daft.
Yeah, like
what you
Mandalorian
can see.
Almost. Like,
I think
the Mandalorian does like a really good job of that.
Yeah,
as well, like,
the swagger and the look. And he's got, what's great, so, you know, the layout of the film, when Dredd takes on Anderson, they go into this tower block and it gets locked down pretty quick and they are stuck in there, and basically it's like a video game. They've got to get to the top level, take out the boss to get out, right?
You've literally echoed like so much of my own thoughts about it.
So once they kind of establish that, you're following it. But what's amazing is Anderson's a really good character because she's a telepathic, is that the right one for this?
She can see what people are thinking or see what people are going to do before they do it.
But she's a good in for the audience because straight away we feel sorry for her because they say, oh, you know, Dredd's quite against having her. One, because she's almost failed, and an almost fail in Dredd's world is you failed. There is no the middle line. It's the hard line. And number two, he goes, oh, she's a mutant. And there's a bit of a, oh, okay, there's an issue with mutants. And
it doesn't really go into that, though, does it?
Well, it's done very subtly. She says, we've made an exception for that, we know, because... Yeah. And it's the idea think about how many crimes we could stop if we had someone like her, okay? But what she is for us as an audience is she's a way in because she sees the world differently to how Dredd sees it. Dredd is worn down by all this, and it's very black and white. She gets you thinking throughout the film the consequences of his actions in terms of, okay, they live in this tower block with 76 levels or whatever it is, and Mama's at the top. But a lot of the people who live there aren't involved. They just happen to live there, and they're good people. They're just in a bad situation, wrong place, wrong time. And Dredd doesn't really account for that. And throughout the film, you can see I can't say he's softening, but he's seeing her viewpoint more. And he says to her straight away at the start of the film, if you lose your weapon, it is an automatic fail. And when she loses her weapon, your heart sinks as an audience. You think, that's it. And you see character development because that does not pan out the way you would expect it to pan out.
I was happy, like, the fact that you do get that character development and it's a swift 95 minutes, which I love nowadays. Like, I don't want a 2-hour 12 minute film, which apparently every film is 2 hours and 12 minutes nowadays.
Yeah. It's pretty standard.
The thing I did look at was the budget, which was 45 million. And then obviously Judge Dredd, the budget for that was 90 million.
Yeah, and you've got to think at that time as well where that money went. But
where did it go?
Well, no, to be fair, a lot of it went on building that one street they used in Judge Dredd and reshot multiple times, if you remember. There's basically What a lot of fans apparently said at the time, the first 15 minutes of the 95 Dredd movie they love because it's actually like the comics. He has the helmet on, he's doing his job. Soon as it's, I'm taking my helmet off, and they kind of... Someone described it as a Greek tragedy. It's the one thing he represents is the thing that then goes against him. What does he do? And the idea of it sounds like, I'm making this sound a hell of a lot better than it actually is, but that's kind of the setup.
No, I think the story's there. Yeah.
But this was basically saying, here's a day in the life of Dredd. And it's not end of the world. It's not high stakes. It's one tower block, and for the grand scheme of things, that's pretty, I say low brow, but it's pretty low stakes. But some interesting points on that. So apparently in the original script it was harsher. I think I've touched on this briefly before. So in the opening scene they were going to have a thing where he shoots through a bystander to get the criminal, because he's like, I calculates the risk of saying, oh, she'll be fine. But apparently this is harsher than he actually is in the comics. This is like a level too far, right?
A bit too, yeah.
Okay,
too far.
So that was interesting to me. But there's another part at the end. They actually changed the ending, because at the end of the film, we've already discussed, he gets Mama and he throws her down, and literally she goes down 76 floors in slow-mo.
And guess what song's playing? The song that plays... as she's falling down is actually a Justin Bieber track, slowed down 800 times.
Wow. Okay. Which sounds crazy, but when you hear it, you'll see why that is the way it is. It kind of makes sense. But yeah, he throws her out that window. And in the original, in this version of the script, she says to him, I have a bomb on my hand. And my heartbeat stops, this bomb goes off. And Dredd, very nonplussed, it kind of ignores her and throws her off the ledge anyway. And when it doesn't go off, he's like, yeah, fine, thought so. But in the original script, they didn't have the bomb thing, and it looked worse because Dredd basically got this woman who he's just gone up fighting for an hour and a half and just threw her off a ledge with no context, and it just looked a bit too...
You know, cutthroat.
A bit that there's cutthroat.
I am
right?
the law.
Yeah, I am the law. Bang, off you go.
When he said that, I was like,
were you
so
buzzing?
Hyped. I was like, yes. Yeah. Like, but Stallone says it better. The only other thing I've got is, like, as I said, I'm obsessed with budgets. And do you know what does my head in? And I understand why, because Dredd made zero money, but we get 22 Marvel films, and I can't have a Dredd 2. The cheapest Marvel film, ironically, was Ant-Man at $130 million.
I would say, though, the odds of someone buying up Dredd and doing it,
Disney will probably buy it up and ruin it.
I get the impression with Dredd what happened was, by the time they'd spent their marketing budget. So we should talk about this, because we briefly mentioned the 3D, okay? It was a botched release, because in America, a lot of places didn't release it. They had to go far and wide to actually get to see it. It didn't get a massive release. It did well in the UK. Yeah. It was actually...
Like, it is an indie film, essentially, isn't it?
Yeah, it was top of the UK box office for the first weekend, and then it had good word of mouth. But it's one of those films which didn't get the numbers, but everyone who saw it said they liked it. And it's one of those films where you could need the opposite, where if it was actually trash and got lots of money, a la every Transformer film after, like, 3 that kept going... then they'll still make them, but Dredd didn't do that. But it's a hard thing to market, because it's not a superhero film. It's very dark. But I think a lot of people were put off by the 3D. They really, at the time, called it Dredd 3D. And everyone thought, is this a sequel to the other one? Because it wasn't marketed clearly enough.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Is it a reboot? Because they weren't calling it a reboot. And then they said,
to your average Joe.
I could only see it in 3D. I don't want to see it in 3D. And this is the problem that the film faced. And it's a shame, because Carl Urban's obviously now doing The Boys, which is a TV show. And they're talking about Mega City 1 being a TV show, and Dredd kind of coming in and out. And he said he'd be up for it, but... I haven't heard about that for a while, and it sounds like one of those things which is a nice idea which won't happen, much like the Neil Blomkamp Alien 5. We saw the production art and thought, great, this is greenlit, it's going to happen, and then within 18 months it just kind of petered out, and that's how it's been. And probably with everything that's happened in 2020, without getting too into it, probably hasn't helped if they had anything prepped and it's not gone ahead and people are losing money as they're writing and going. But another few production issues with this film, actually, which I hadn't really heard of before. Carl Urban actually claims, like, Alex Garland is the true director of this film. Alex Garland was the writer of the film. He wrote the Danny Boyle films, including 28 Days Later, Sunshine. Yeah. But apparently he was very much the director of this film, which I found really interesting, to the point where apparently the director wasn't in most of the edit for a large portion of time.
So what was the director doing? Because I actually looked at the director and I was I hadn't seen any. I've seen Vantage Point, I think, ages ago.
Yeah, Vantage. I remember Vantage Point. I remember thinking I liked it, but I will have to double check.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, it's been
a while
since I've seen it. That's the only thing of note.
It sounds like, and I'm reading between the lines here, I obviously wasn't on set, take it for what it is. With Marvel films, when they have someone come in, they have their action director and they have their people director, right? And basically, people who don't do Marvel films complain because they say, I want to do all of it. And they turn and say, no, we have our action team. They direct that. You come and do the character moments, okay?
Yeah.
I get the impression that what might have happened with this was Alex Garland was very much in charge of most of the non-actiony scenes, and it was like, this guy knows how to cover it all. But he actually went for petitioned for him to get a co-directing credit, which he then didn't do. So I think there's a lot of stuff going on there, and maybe that has issues with the production wranglings for if there is potentially a second one. I don't know, like, maybe that's part of the issue. I found that interesting.
I would love to see just a direct sequel to it.
The thing is, I think there's a whole world to be explored, and truly we've seen one tower block of it, and it's the film's great for showing it in that way, but you want to see more, and I think they would have expanded, because we hear straight away about the desert wasteland, and I think we would have seen that and you know, gone into where those mutants are. There's a lot of lore to go out, I get the impression.
Oh God, yeah, there's literally, I think there's about 20 volumes, but... Anyway, so if anyone is really up for a gritty, dirty, like realistic sort of filthy film that makes you feel like you need a shower afterwards, Dredd is a fantastic action film.
Definitely. So it's currently on Netflix as well. So
yeah, it's on Netflix now. Yeah, it's worth checking out. You will see a couple of dodgy green screens here and there, but it mostly looks great for the most part, and I just can't fault it. I really can't fault it at all. I loved it. So what we're going to do now is actually do a little pairing of the film. So Johnny's got his pairing ready. I've got my pairing ready. And what we're going to do is we're just going to, like, what would be a good double feature with this? Like, what's in the same vein?
Okay, so I mentioned to Jamie that I hadn't seen The Raid prior to watching Dredd, and he said, you must watch them because a lot of people compare the two films. So I did watch The Raid for the first time, and before I go into that...
Oh man, I've been dying to talk to
you. Yeah,
I
know, and I'm same. So just before we get into that, I just want to clarify, a lot of people say Dredd is a Raid rip-off, it's very much the same. The script for Dredd was written by the time they were already filming The Raid, so it's not a fact of The Raid came out and then Dredd copied the look and then did it quite the opposite. I think the director and producer Dredd must have been banging their heads against a brick wall when they saw The Raid get released and see how similar it is. I would say, though, it's one of those where it's kind of like saying, you know, I find both those films very similar to Die Hard, which also takes place in one building. So it is what it is. Yeah. And also, having one location for a whole film is not a new thing. So I wouldn't obsess over it.
Of course not, no.
Yeah,
plenty one location movies.
It's just an easy stick to beat it with, and that kind of frustrated me. However, The Raid, I absolutely loved it. So we've chatted briefly about my issue with lots of gore and violence. However, in The Raid, I found it very enjoyable.
Really?
Yeah.
I can't believe this.
What's amazing with The Raid is, although it's violent and there can be quite a lot of blood sections and stuff, there's also scenes where you think they're going to show the brutal shot and they don't. They're actually very clever with how they cut.
They hold back. Yeah.
Yeah, so I really enjoyed it. I thought, much like with Dredd, it's a less is more situation. There's not a lot of locations, funnily enough. You literally see an apartment at the start, run a road, and then we're in. The only thing I say when I watch films that obviously aren't in English, because obviously this was subtitled.
Indonesian.
I find it really hard to know if the acting's good or not, because if you don't speak the language, you don't know if someone's being over the top or melodramatic. You just see it for what it is.
Yeah,
but this is just a general
general
statement. This is nothing particular on The Raid, but it was just something I was thinking as I was watching it. I thought, I wonder if someone watches this and says, they're really overhamming this dialogue. We never know. We just see it for what it is.
Well, to our Indonesian listeners... all of our Indonesian listeners, I'll come to that. We actually got a question, so maybe we do have an Indonesian listener for the first episode that hasn't been released yet.
Yep.
let us know. Like, is what is the raid like? In
is
like,
it over dramatic? Is it a hammy delivery, or is it genuinely well acted film?
Is it JCVD? Like, is it Jean-Claude Van Damme?
Yeah,
like, kind of like,
that's what I mean. Though
I would never know. I would never know. And Iko Uwe could be a terrible actor, but a fantastic martial artist.
It's just one of those things that your brain starts churning it over, then you can't stop thinking about it for the rest of the film. But no, the film. I genuinely found that film stressful. It's also only an hour and 40 minutes long, but the pacing is relentless. The first hour is nonstop. The energy, had he directed any films prior to this, or was this his
Gareth
first?
Gareth Evans.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Because it felt to me...
No, I think he's only directed maybe... He'd done that, he'd done The Raid 2, and he'd done Apostle.
Yeah, so for me...
And he's done that new TV show, Gangs of London.
London, yeah. Okay, so that...
Which is amazing as well.
The energy in that opening... I say the opening sequence, but the opening sequence is like an hour long, so that's probably not a good way of describing it. But it's shown through. It's a SWAT team. They're in a van. They get out of the van. They go up a building. Sounds very simple, but the way it's shot and executed, you feel like you are consistently running and moving with them. The camera doesn't stop. It's not like Jason Bourne shaky cam, though. It's hard to describe. The camera's always moving, but you feel very much part of it.
Yeah, because unlike Jason Bourne, there's actual real martial artists in there that can do the stunts, so you don't need any of the shaky camera quick cuts.
Yeah, but
it's amongst the... When I watched The Raid, I love martial arts films anyway, so I'd seen... like the Ong Bak films, Warrior King, like Tony Jaa, like all that kind of thing. Like, I grew up on like Jet Li, Jackie Chan, but I had never seen anything like The Raid, like in terms of like how brutal it was.
Yeah.
In terms of like how it's literally like a heart attack. Like, it's almost like, yeah, it could have been directed by the Safdie brothers.
Yeah, I think the scene which, the only one which truly grossed me out, there's a scene with
the knee.
No, not that one. There was one with a machete going in, and the guy still fights after he receives like a machete to the shoulder blade. Yeah. And I thought, I'm just feeling that, thinking, oh my God. It's the way I should have described this is a visceral experience. It's almost like being on a roller coaster, which sounds so cliche, but I had it on and just felt... I paused it on the hour mark to go and have a drink.
Really?
Was, honest to God.
Have a breather.
Just have a breather, because it was so intense. I just thought, my God. But the action is really, really good. But what I was going to say was there's a teamed up fight later on in the film. And I think they break a lighting fixture.
Oh, is it when the two... Ooh. So the two guys from the SWAT team are both fighting that guy, and he's
no, I think it's the guy and his brother, right? So it's one of the SWAT team guys.
They
basically have this light fixture which they have broken, and he uses it as a knife, and oh God, it's just brutal. But yeah, the fight choreography and everything's amazing. And what I really enjoy watching this stuff is contextualizing it with what came after it, you know? And the Daredevil TV series would not have happened in my head without The Raid, because the whole fighting style is very similar, that kind of thing.
And like you keep saying, the choreography is unlike anything I've ever seen.
But much energy. It feels like sometimes when directors have their films towards the start of their career, you can feel like they have poured their heart and soul into it. And when you watch that film, you feel... It's all been left out on the field, right? You
I've know, got nothing left.
I've got nothing left. This is it. If this is my one shot to make my one film, this is what it's going to be remembered for. And that's what it felt like. I've just watched the trailer for the second one. And what's amazing
I think it's better.
The production value, you instantly see it's gone to 2:3:5 aspect ratio straight away. So they've obviously got more budget, and the cinematography and the lighting's a bit better. And it's the stuff I thought, okay, they've got production value, they've got money behind them. But there's something to be said for the raw energy of those earlier ones. So like I was saying with Spielberg and Raiders of the Lost Ark, when they actually had a bit less budget, there's kind of more to it, because it's a bit rough and ready and you feel that energy, and it's just, it's great. Absolutely loved it. So that was my pairing. Jamie, what was yours?
So I thought about the overall premise of the film, and it actually just drew me into John Carpenter, who is he loves putting people in really difficult situations that they can't get out of. So hence like Halloween, obviously. People are probably already know already. I decided to go with Escape from New York with Kurt Russell. So I hadn't seen it in years. And so this is actually really funny. I watched it years ago when I was a teen, and I was like, yeah, that's, I love that film. Like, love the part with the basketball hoop. Like, and everyone's going to be sitting there like, no, that's not that film. And I'm like, nah, it's not that film. You're right. Because I'd never seen Escape from New York. I'd seen Escape from LA, which I have on DVD, which is well funny. So I watched Escape from New York. And it was awesome. Like, I really loved it. I was just waiting for that basketball bit the whole time. Have you seen Escape from LA? Probably not.
I'm confused on which one I have seen. I just said to you, is it Kurt Russell with an eye patch? To which you said yes. Yeah, and that was exactly. About as far as I went. But I remember a paraglider, but I'm now trying to work out if that's a completely different film.
So he's not in a paraglider. He's in...
Is he like on some contraptions like a little, hanging like... from? I don't know.
I don't think so, no.
Okay, wrong.
He was... I mean, maybe you've seen the same one as me then. At the end of... So New York was the beginning one, 1981, Escape from New York. And basically, what essentially is, for those who don't know, Manhattan is essentially the whole of Manhattan, the island, is now a prison. It's, again, post-apocalyptic, like dystopian wasteland kind of thing. And people go there to either... They get thrown into Manhattan and they do as they please, or they can choose death. So they don't have to go in. They can choose like like to be killed. So Kurt Russell goes in. He's like an ex like army vet with like three purple hearts. Like all this, like you know he's the daddy, and he essentially like so the president. He just happens to be he's going for this peace treaty thing across like in an airplane. The airplane crashes and he gets kidnapped. And so they ask Snake Plissken, coolest name ever. They ask Snake Plissken to go and rescue the president, and they inject him in the neck with these, I don't know what it is, but essentially in 24 hours, if he doesn't get the president back, it like they pop and open up his arteries and kill him. So
sounds like Suicide Squad, really. Go and get the person out of that building before they blow up, right?
I wonder where they got that idea from. So that's essentially like the plot and like. Like Kurt Russell just plays him so well, like it's just amazing. Like obviously John Carpenter and Kurt Russell have got a little thing going because he's obviously used him many times, like in the Thing as well, and again in Escape from LA, which it was the one I'd seen. So yeah, so I chose that, and it's great. The pacing a little bit slow, like in the middle, like it does slow down a bit, but it's sort of like that dark, grimy kind of. Same sort of premise as Dredd. So
you feel like you need a shower after you've watched it.
Exactly.
No, I love these films. Honestly, like... I felt this weekend I did Dredd and The Raid back to back with pretty much day after day, right? And I honestly thought I need to watch something quite uplifting because I've just watched two tower blocks get completely annihilated in this dystopian world. Doesn't make you feel great. Well, I suppose The Raid's not dystopian world, but it makes you feel like it's a pretty grim place to be. So then I watched 10 Things I Hate About You for the first time.
Yes.
So that was the moral uplift I needed at that point.
That needs to be another episode. Like we need definitely. To do a teen, like teen
feels like teen
episode.
Spirit. Like,
I absolutely love 10 Things I Hate About You. One of my favorites, and like another great soundtrack.
Really good.
Anyway, right. Sorry. So we've talked about Dredd for ages.
We have.
And you're all dreaded out. So we are now going to move on, which is hopefully going to be a mainstay every podcast. We're going to move on to some questions, which I put out to my many, many, many Instagram followers.
Jamie has a little joke. All the
not
Instagram followers.
Not
all
that
of
many.
Them. Yep.
Not that many. But, I mean, you can always follow at Movies in a Nutshell if you want. And you can see me give my Tuesday recommendations. So I basically asked my followers like what if they've got any questions for us, and now I'm just about to pull them up. Probably should have been better prepared, but here we are again. Give me that leeway. It's our first ever podcast, so allow me to fill your ears with noise while I find this screenshot. Here we go. Right, so a couple of interesting ones, a couple of ones that we're really going to struggle to answer actually, because we just don't know. So I'm just going to go from the top. So one of my friends on Instagram, Kim's Cinema Escape, asks, what are your Oscar predictions? So I'm going to be honest, I've not seen that many 2020 films. I literally just put out a post of my top 20. So please allow me to bring that up. So my, I guess an obvious kind of one I'd be looking at would be Mank. I've not seen it though, so what can I say? Like, Jonny, have you got anything?
I really haven't. And what I would say is, if anyone has any recommendations of films from 2020 which they think we should watch, please do send them in, because I would be really interested in seeing them. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that, with everything that went on last year, that did kind of slip by the wayside. I will admit that I let a lot go and didn't see everything I should have seen. So if you do have any that you think we should see, that you think probably would be up for Oscar nomination, I would be intrigued and I'd like to see it.
I mean the only ones that I could really, what I'd love to see win some nominations would be The Invisible Man, because that was my favorite from the from 2020. I know, Jonny, you've probably not seen it because
not seen it yet, but I did actually go to watch it. Jamie's about to say John wouldn't watch it because it's a horror. However, I showed Harriet the trailer, my partner the trailer, and she wasn't sold, but I will watch it. Maybe we get to talk about it on here. I'd be quite keen.
It's really good. Like, and do you know what? Maybe we could do a double bill. Maybe we could do a Lee Wan-L double bill, because he made another film that I'm just not even going to mention just yet.
Okay.
Because I just don't shut up about it. Right. So I would say maybe I would really like to see Elizabeth Moss win Best Actress, because she's unbelievable in that film. I'd like to see Host win something. So Host, do you know the film Host, Jonny?
I don't know, sorry.
No, so the film's essentially like, it's a short film, like maybe 60 minutes, like, so not classed as a short film, but it's essentially like a Zoom call, and they do a seance during a Zoom call, and it all goes tits up.
And he wonders if I'd seen this. I mean, surely you knew from that very plot that
I would not have seen it. Mate, I tell you now, it's terrifying. Like, I find... like those kind of films, like, you know, the
found footage,
found footage films. It's not found footage, but it's on a Zoom call. Like, it just feels so real. So that would be, I'd love to see that. I mean, the rest, really, like, I really, really loved The Way Back with Ben Affleck this year, because it was nice to see him, like, sort of back at his best. Cause I know he's had a lot of problems, in his personal life. I mean, obviously Birds of Prey might win, best costume design, that
best
kind
hair
of thing.
And makeup again.
Best hair and makeup. Like Suicide Squad.
I loved it when
other stuff.
Suicide Squad had on the box for ages the Oscar-winning Suicide Squad, and it was just hilarious. I just loved the fact they would plaster it on all the marketing, and it was.
Love it.
And no, that's not to knock. Let me be clear, not to knock the hair and makeup, because to be fair, the hair and makeup in that film is incredibly good. That's not a knock for that, but making out as if it was like this 5-star prestigious film, and we all know.
And
what
do we think? Do we think Tenet might win Best Sound Editing?
Oh, I'm going to say no.
No, but it might win Best, could be Best Visual Effects, maybe.
I did enjoy the other day that podcast said that Blu-ray should just go with the marketing campaign of it's got subtitles and people would be more likely to buy it. So,
I did see that.
I enjoyed it.
Right, so next one. This is a joke question. What's your favourite thing about Grease and why?
I mean,
I'll tell you what's my favorite thing about Greece, leather pants, leather trousers. That's what's my favorite thing about Greece, because that's the only good thing about Greece.
I'll be honest.
Yeah,
I was gonna say the flying car, because that means it's the end. But
the flying car,
right? The end. The car flies, and it's really weird. It's really, weird.
So I mean, I'm not the biggest Grease fan, to be honest. I don't mind musicals.
I must say, that I was in at high school, secondary school, whatever you want to call it. I was Danny Zuko in Grease, so I am fond of the Grease lightning routine.
Look at you, man. Gorgeous.
This is it. So
looks exactly like him as well.
I wouldn't go with that. So yeah, maybe that sequence, probably because I had to watch it the most times to learn it. But aside from that, not got much to comment on.
Grease. Yeah, I mean, yeah, exactly. The cars. Do you know what? I'm going to go with the cars. The cars is probably the best thing about it for me, because I love those old school type of cars. Like
big 1950s really nice American muscle. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Love They've it. Got the wings on the back. They're just really cool. So next question is, do you know what? It's really bizarre that this was asked. So Stan for Films has asked, have you ever watched an Indonesian movie except The Raid, of course?
Oh, I'm out. So, I'm done.
Yeah. I mean, so I have actually.
Because he watched The Raid 2, so obviously he has ticked both those boxes.
No, actually. So I have watched The Raid 2. But, I mean, for me, Stanford Films, please give me a list of your five, the five best Indonesian films that you think like everyone should watch.
Yeah,
so 100%. I have actually seen other ones, but they're all in the same vein. So I've seen Headshot, which again, starring Iko Uwe. Mm-hmm. Is another kind of like crime martial arts film, and I've seen The Night Comes for Us, again starring Iko Uwe, which is another like martial arts crime film. And as you can see, like, I feel a bit embarrassed, but do you know what, and obviously I've seen The Raid 2. Yeah, please give me, or anyone of our Indonesian listeners, I'm sure there's many of you, give us some Indonesian films to watch, and we'll review one on the podcast. Love to
definitely.
Jonny, I'm assuming, yeah, sorry, I kind of dismissed you there.
No, I ruled myself out pretty early on. As I said earlier in the podcast, I need to get better, and I completely agree. Any recommendations, brilliant. Love it.
Okay. So last two questions then. We've got one from Film Forager, another one of my friends. Chandra asks, this is niche, but I liked it. Favorite beer drinking scenes in films?
Yes. Wow. Okay. For this, I am going for... you're gonna laugh straight away. Fight Club. After they're having beers in the street, and then they decide to start. They have golf clubs, and they're like smashing up cars. And they're not smashing up the cars. They are putting the golf balls all over the shop, and it's smashing into windows and stuff. But I think there's some. I don't know if this is true or not. I don't know if it's an IMDb trivia thing, but I think people didn't know they were filming the film, and they just thought people were just smashing up the street. So I think the police got called on them. But yeah, they were drinking. I can't remember if it was Budweiser's or maybe... Didn't Brad Pitt have a deal with Heineken for a while or something? I can't remember. So probably. Maybe he was drinking...
He ain't got a beer belly, put it that way.
No, he's got a bod and a half.
Wish he has got a pure bod.
So that'd be mine. How about yours?
So mine would probably be either... So like maybe one of two. Like, and I guess they're kind of in the same vein. So the first one that came to mind was Superbad. When they're the cops, you know, the cops are drinking and they're dancing to Fuck the Police.
I think they are.
That cracks me up. But the other one, I don't know if you've seen it actually. Maybe we watch it together. Have you seen Old School with Will Ferrell?
I don't know. Maybe. Okay.
Well, yeah, you would know. So like Old School, Will Ferrell, basically it's like a bunch of like basically middle-aged men who like start throwing like... They start a fraternity, and like they start from
Vince Vaughn. I have seen Will Ferrell. I think we watched it together, maybe.
Yeah, but blatantly, like, so I love it. So obviously Will Ferrell is he turns into a character called Frank the Tank, and he's like, and everyone's like, so he's doing like beer bongs and stuff, and everyone's like, Frank the Tank, and then he gets absolutely hammered, and he's like running through the streets naked, and his wife that he's just married is like driving with her friends, and she sees him really pissed, and he's like, Frank, what are you doing? Like, and she's like really embarrassed, and he's like, we're going streaking through the gymnasium around the quads, like, and it's really funny, and he gets in the car naked with her friends. Absolutely hilarious.
Love
so
it.
There you go, that's my favorite beer drinking scene in the film. Last question before we round up this podcast, first ever podcast, by Vincent 333. So Vincent says, what's a movie you guys had to pretend to like in front of others but actually hated? Did I send you this one?
Yeah,
this might have been a last minute.
I think you did send it. It rings a bell. You go first.
So a movie you guys had to pretend to like in front of others but actually hated. I mean, I'm far too opinionated to...
Jamie sticks to his guns whether he loves it or hates it. I think I'm here to bring balance. He's very passionate on something being great or not great. I try and see it a bit differently.
Johnny's definitely the balance to the force.
I try.
I'm sure we're gonna have some real fun conversations in the future.
But let me tell you, we do disagree quite a lot on certain films, which is gonna be interesting at a later date. But I think in terms of... I'm really struggling to think of one, but I would say at university especially, you know when people say, you must watch this, you must like this.
Yeah. And I know this isn't a film, but I watched the first few episodes of Game of Thrones that you, when we were at uni together, and I wasn't bothered, and you were just could not believe that I couldn't get into it, and I don't know, it just didn't strike the right chord with me, and that's the closest I've probably come to pretend. Yeah. It's, you know, when however many years Game of Thrones was going, if you went out and did drinking games and stuff, Game of Thrones is part of it. It was far easier to say you liked Game of Thrones than say you didn't watch it. You know, it's one of those.
I'd agree with that.
Yeah, I maybe mean, that.
The only thing I will say is, and I don't want to keep like mentioning like that I've got an Instagram account. So it's like, well, I've got an Instagram account, like very good. Like carry on mentioning it, plugging it, and at moviesinanutshell.com. Right. Anyway, but having that definitely does affect the way you watch films, because you see like so you see so much hype for certain films. So a really really good example would be Under the Skin. So I went into that like. Have you seen Under the Skin? It's Scarlett Johansson.
I have indeed, and I can imagine exactly why you don't like it.
Oh right. Oh yes. Yeah. Right. I'm buzzing that actually you've seen it, because I hadn't expected you to see it. I went in and watched that and absolutely hated it. Okay. It was so slow.
Yeah,
and boring.
I was going to say for you, it's. I know. I find it. Sometimes you're a bit of a contradiction to me, because you watch a lot of older cinema, which usually has a slower pace. But then if it's a more modern film with a slower pace, you normally don't get on board with it that much,
because it doesn't have that style and that romance that an old film has.
Yeah, so like, 100%.
For me, Under the Skin was like. I was about to say I could have made it, which would have been well funny.
I don't think that's true.
Imagine
but,
if I said that.
Yeah,
I kind of just did. I don't know. I don't know what it was like. I normally love anything Scarlett Johansson's in, because she's a fantastic actress. But with that film in particular, I found it awful. Like, do you know what I prefer? I prefer the film Species. That's a better version of it. Which is
that's
like
H.R. Giger doing something else that's not Alien, to be fair, with Species.
I mean that's a really, that's probably the best example I can give, is that the expectations from a lot of other people, like a lot of other cinephiles, like I don't really class myself as a cinephile, I just like watching films, like I just watch films and I enjoy them for the most part, but it's upset, like, so I'm trying, it's weird for me to like try and explain this. So like what I was going to say earlier, well, like when I used to go to car boot sales and stuff before social media, before Letterboxd, and we could track our films, I just used to buy films where I liked the look of the cover.
Yeah.
And that's how I found most films. And so nowadays, when you can't help but like come across like how people feel about films, it's a constant bombardment. And we're doing the same thing right now.
100%.
It's a constant bombardment of being told like if something's good or bad. Like, and when many, many people love Under the Skin, and I go into it and I'm like, what a really boring letdown. I'm just like, I like, it's sad. So sorry, over to you.
All I was gonna say was, and this is something I hope people take away from this, is although we have our views on it, that doesn't mean our views are particularly right or wrong. I would just say it's just our opinions, and that's what we're here for, and I hope it gives some insight to as well with the productions. But I really can't think of one, but I am a bit of a sucker for, I will defend films sometimes to the point where I think maybe I should take a step back, because you should never force someone to try and like something.
Really? I thought that was my job.
Well, no, but I'd say, you know, for example, no, I'm not going to give my example. We'll say
Alien
for later.
3.
No, let's not get into it. It's okay. not today. But I just say, you know, there's certain films which... We've talked about the idea of like a 6 out of 10 isn't always a bad thing, right? You know, sometimes people say it's a terrible film, and it's like, it's not terrible. You just don't enjoy it. That's fine.
I have so much fun with 6 out of 10s.
Yeah. And like, so if you're in the right mood, in the right time, you can watch a film like that, and it can really, and really hit home.
Hereditary. Switch your brain off. 6 out of 10. I'm joking. Everyone loves Hereditary. That was just my little joke, little dig. I love a mindless 6 out of 10. You know, when you finish work and you're tired and you don't want to watch a Nolan film because you know that you won't get up in the morning and it'll make your head explode.
Like, and you'll have to read on the internet for at least an hour to fully understand the plot. Yeah. And then, you know.
Love a Batman Forever. Like, do you know what I mean? Like, it's. So, yeah. Apart from when I was a kid, that would be the only real time. I kind of digressed that question, but do you know what? Thank you, Vincent, for your question, because it sparked a nice little discussion. And unfortunately for all of you guys, that is it. We're done. It's the first ever, first and last, first episode of our podcast. We will be back. That was me just making a joke, but we will be back with a second episode in probably about a fortnight. We don't know what we're going to... it's going to be a similar format, apart from the first bit. But yeah, we're going to have another feature film. We're not sure. Do you know what? If you want it, if we get enough people asking, let us know what you want us to talk about, and we'll do a bit of homework. We'd love that. But yeah, apart from that, yeah, find me, ask me questions at Movies in a Nutshell. Jonny.
At jcb.video on Instagram, if anyone wants to follow. I'm a videographer, yep. So there's lots of video posts.
Exactly. Lots of, yeah. The next Fincher. sorry. Yeah, anyway, guys, that is it. See you guys later. See you next time. Thanks very much for listening.
Thank you. Bye.